Here's the issue with AI. I'm tired of generating text and uncanny images. How can I build an AI assistant that can actually interact with the applications that I use daily? Today's video, I build an AI assistant that can interact with all of my applications that I use as my daily drivers.
Righto, Lewis. All done and dusted, sir.
I can tell that's gonna get really annoying really fast. So first, let me explain where we're at with generative AI. Although the models are getting much smarter and much bigger, they still only generate text. And I'm just so fatigued of the generating text, like we get it. But over a year ago, OpenAI announced a fine-tuned version of GPT-3 and 4 called function calling, which gives a structured output in JSON format. And when I first read this post, I thought that this was going to change everything. Like this opened up the floodgates, but it really didn't. Function calling is quick, sort of. But when I was at Microsoft Build this year, one of the biggest announcements was the Phi 3 models, which are really fast and really, really small. Imagine how fast it can go if it was the speed of one of these models, just constantly taking actions extremely fast. So here's what we're going to be building out. When a user submits their query, the AI determines the ask. It will then decide what tool to use. Each tool is powered by another AI specifically designed for the task at hand. So for example, the AI for code is better at coding, while the calendar schedule is better at extracting exact information. Depending on the query, the AI will delegate the task to one or many AI models to get the task complete. The AI will then determine if the task is complete and give me a rundown of everything that has worked. It will also have the ability to look into a database and see if some external tools are needed. And it seems pretty straightforward, but it actually kind of all boiled down to the little nitty-gritty details. And in the end, I created something crazy, so let's go. So we have three heavy boys coming into this right off the bat: Python, JavaScript, and Docker. Basically a gigantic buffet of cache and packages. So I'm going to create a dev drive on Windows, which is relatively new. I actually spoke directly with Adam and Bridget, two developers who worked on dev drive at Microsoft Build. They told me that dev drive uses the resilient file system, which for my use case can take advantage of something called block cloning, which means when I move my existing dependencies or cache over from one drive to the dev drive, it will copy over using the metadata rather than copying the whole thing from scratch. After that, I can go on dev home and transfer all of my cache files to that dev drive, freeing up a ton of space on my regular drive. Also, I get to have an L drive. L for Lewis, moving on. Python setup is actually pretty easy. We're actually gonna have two projects here, the AI assistant and then the fine tuning and the training of specific models, but we'll get to that later. I explained on my second channel how much the AI app development ecosystem is extremely bloated, with LangChain being at the top of this. And without reiterating on that video, these AI app frameworks and libraries often abstract away from concepts in ways that just feel counterproductive. And after some research, I decided I'm going to give this one framework a try called Langroid. Langroid is a lightweight multi-agent framework where each agent is assigned tasks and tools where they communicate back and forth with each other. Ideally, under circumstances where I need something to go through multiple steps, this will be smart enough to facilitate the entire transaction, hopefully. Let's start out by creating a little demo project. I'll include Langroid in a file with some hard-coded attributes. I will then create an agent that can connect with the Todoist API. And that's my to-do app that I use constantly. Already though, I'm starting to see issues present itself. I have to add in a lot of code for the Todoist integration, which also had to be tested. And what makes this cool too is that you can see the reasoning the LLM has to do in order to complete the task. Now it's a bit slow at the moment because we have to wait for the OpenAI to return a response every single thought and then transfer that information back to us through the network, which I know. In the grand scheme of things, it's actually pretty fast, but you know, I want this to be lightning fast. Just get right on with it. Right now though, the experience just kind of sucks. It's just text input in my terminal. But do you know what also sucks? Voice assistants. I feel so embarrassed using them, and I just really don't care for this feeling of another family member watching me at all times. But I can't deny though, that is an effective way to get the thoughts out of your head into the real world somehow. Of course, this means I have to implement Whisper from OpenAI, which takes a voice clip and transcribes the text. Many sizes of this model exist, going from tiny to large. Now let's try the same sentence on tiny to small. Now with the base model, we get about half a second to transcribe. Moving up to small.en, we were able to get 0.63 seconds. Surprisingly, tiny was only a tiny, I wrote that in the script, bit better than the base model. At the same time, proper nouns like Todoist weren't able to be picked up in the tiny model. I could really go for any of the three, but my choice will be the base English version for having that balance of proper noun understanding and speed. Also, let's go into dev home and look up the CPU and GPU metrics as I run these. Since we're going to be running local models on our GPU, we don't want to use up all the VRAM that's available on my NVIDIA card. I created a dedicated button with this keyboard I don't really use that I will mount under my desk. I want to be able to hold the button and then the bot listens. When I go, the command is over. And I can just quickly rig this up in Python with this code right here. And that just makes the experience much better. Set it and forget it. Hold F24. Which is the button I assigned to under the desk. So remind me tomorrow at 8 p.m. to walk the dog. I had to. I added a voice to it to add a little bit of personality to it.
Righto, Lewis. All done and dusted, sir.
I can tell that's going to get really annoying really fast. To improve the speed, we need to use small models that we can run on our machine. PyTorch will then use CUDA to power the text generation. And this is where the dev drive really came in handy, because reinstalling PyTorch with CUDA is tedious every single time. Now, let's talk about speed. The call to OpenAI through the network, the generation of the text on their servers, and then sending back causes delays. Currently, Redis is being used on WSL to store all of the interactions in memory, and since I'm on WSL already, we could use Ollama to run these models locally. When I fine-tuned a model to caption memes, make sure you check out the full-length video of that, I learned a lot about fine-tuning models. One of the key aspects I learned is that you can fine-tune a model to perform a specific task exceptionally well, even better than some like ChatGPT, which is like 1,000 times bigger. Models like Claude or GPT-4 from ChatGPT are designed to be consumer level, good at everything models. In order for these to appeal to just about everything, they have to get bigger. The bigger they get, the slower they are. But open source models like Phi-3 Mini Instruct strips basically everything away and lets the developer fine-tune it on specific data that it needs. That way you can get the extreme performance of a small model while getting the intelligence on a specific task. And for this, I'm going to use the Unsloth library that can fine-tune 2x faster with half the memory use. How, you ask? Well, good question, I don't know. Let's boot up WSL and look for some datasets. This one right here, xlam function calling 60k, has 60,000 different examples of writing a statement and then the tool calling that happens afterwards. And because the models are so small, I can run this locally on my GPU, but if we ended up wanting to use other ones, then we might have to rent a GPU in order to do this. I was given a demo of Phi-3 at Microsoft Build, where I cloned the mini 3.8 billion parameter model and ran it on native hardware. And take into consideration that GPT-4o could be like trillions of parameters. So when I ran Phi-3 on my own hardware, it was able to do this extremely fast. They obviously built this so that you can easily integrate it into any software you build without it feeling extremely heavy. Now for comparison, GPT-4o takes about 8 seconds, while Phi-3 takes about 0.3 seconds. So I'm going to fine-tune Phi-3 with Unsloth. Similar to what I did in the AI memes video, I'll use my GPU in order to do it. This took me about 7,500 steps in order to do it, which was about 4.5 hours total. Now let's give it a test. Using Open Web UI, you can see that it's really fast with the examples given. But one issue is that it isn't really good at replicating info that I give it. The one I can always just think about: remind me to walk the cat at around 10 p.m. tomorrow. Let's see how fast it goes in comparison. Oh, wow. Wow, that did it really fast. One thing that is extremely dangerous and stupid of me, you know, typical. The AI is able to execute any code that it thinks is correct. I'm going to open up dev home again and create a dev box. I'll also create a winget configuration that downloads Python, PyCharm, and ports the repository over in case the app decides to take everything down with it. Now, last but not least is getting the tools to work. That being said, no matter who you are, you're always using a ton of software, not just one or two. So here's my solution to getting tools that I use easily. The solution isn't perfect, but it follows this chain of command. I use the OpenAPI generator to get the OpenAPI spec and turn it into Python code that can be used. Now, not all softwares have their own specs, but usually you can find some sort of version for it. Once this code has been generated, I then use this one tool called Code2Prompt, which is a Rust package that takes your directory and easily formats it so you can put it in your prompts. This will take all of the generated code that was created so that we can create one centralized function. Then ask an AI to generate us a single file that connects to all of these endpoints that were generated. I made a little UI to streamline this. This was by far the toughest part of the whole project, though. Okay, so this actually took a long time. The project's kind of been all over the place. Everything's still kind of the same. I changed frameworks a little bit. You can see right here that I actually have no organization either. Read my last email for me.
Righto, Lewis. Seems you've received an email from YouTube about a channel membership's bonus program, offering up to $3,000 if you sign up and meet certain conditions, old chap.
Oh, not bad, not bad. Let me see if I can get it to do a chain of commands, I guess. Can you read my last email and then send it to a group message on Slack? Actually, it's not messing up. It just kind of got all the available Slack workspaces there.
Lewis, nice. Old chap, wow. I've got a brief summary for you. Sent YouTube email content to Slack's YouTube inspo channel. All done.
Okay, not bad. Honestly, it could have been worse. I was actually kind of expecting something a bit strange. Yeah, look at this right here. Will is going to be so confused. Now let's try and find a bit of a curveball, I guess you could say. Look online for the worst programming command that you can do and then tag Will on Slack that he should try this and then save it to a file. Okay, let's see. I don't even know how this is gonna go.
Righto, Lewis. Here's the gist of it, old chap. Sent message to Will on Slack, saved info to worstcommandinfo.txt file, and had a bit of a hiccup with the channel not being found. There you are, mate.
So I think because of the Slack, it just doesn't put it all into one place. I wonder if it actually did send, though. Let me go have a look. Oh my God, it actually did send to him. Oh my God, yeah, that's kind of savage right there. Hey, try. And so it actually did save to a file as well right here, worst command saved the whole conversation into it, but it didn't save just the thing. So you can see right here, it kind of saved the whole entire conversation, but I'm kind of impressed with that whole chain of command, just being able to do something.
Don't run this. You will see why.
Let me know if you want to see more of this project, and I'm happy to do it. Thanks to Microsoft Today for sponsoring today's video. I had a blast at Microsoft Build, and it was so cool meeting other developers who are working on the softwares that we use every single day.
Can I have Copilot support?
Oh, yeah. Oh, okay. It's pretty awesome and strange at the same time. Peace out, coders.